see the examples of so many economies worldwide that have a growth rate of a certain percentage, but it seems or sometimes even feels like those percentages don't always reflect the real situation in those societies. So whenever we talk about the GDP, we mention the dynamics of growth, and over the recent several years, we cannot avoid also to mention the impact of innovation and technological progress on the quality of life, whether we talk about wealth or the economic growth. So we can explain that through the best performances in terms of productivity that they can include, and we can only hope for some substantial benefits, even if the quality of life isn't just reduced to economic or material dimensions. So whether we like it or not, it is so obvious that economic system like this has created some kind of cult of productivity. And that's why so many economists now think that it no longer depends on human beings and the quality of their work, as the whole system actually penalizes those who work properly. Also, it's not just a simple economic system, but a real fact that all this also includes consciousness and behaviors, which can also be applied to people's emotions and what actually happens when they feel love or happiness and how they are being stimulated by that, but also what happens when people suffer or feeling anxiousness, or when they start drinking heavily or use drugs, and how that all reflects to their lives, their well-being and the whole economy. So on the other side, the usual measure of growth is the nominal GDP, which calculates the output level of an economy compared to the previous year. And this is based on the measurement of the expenses of the different economic agents. So the macroeconomic equation that we are all used to is this famous formula that GDP is equal C plus I plus G plus in parentheses X minus M. And in this formula, C represents household consumption expenditure, I means business investment expenditure, G stands for public expenditure, X stands for exports, and M stands for the imports. But this is just a formula that is not that doesn't reflect the reality, because among the usual critics of this type of measurement, it is generally noted that it does not incorporate the reality of elements in some significant cases, such as, for example, black market or the productivity of, for example, person who performs some part-time job from home, etc. So in order to prevent the same production from being included more than once in this formula, we tend to have only final goods and services. And by that we mean consumer goods and services and capital goods to be included in the formula of GDP. And in addition to that, the intermediate production goods are being excluded from this formula. The best example for that is, for example, the wheat of which the bread is being made, and the wheat is excluded, though the bread itself is actually included in this formula. So when defined by production, GDP is equal to the sum of the added values of resident economic agents calculated at market prices, to which we add some share value added that are usually given by the state, such as the value added tax, customs, etc. But when defined as expenditure, GDP is equal to the sum of domestic end uses of goods and services, which includes the actual final consumption, investment, and certain changes in the inventory. So this definition arises from the accounting equality between the resources of the economy, where we mean GDP, and also how these resources are being used. All this shows actually how GDP is such an imperfect indicator. It was intended to reduce unemployment rate, and through which it was intended to multiply the economy, actually to boost the GDP growth. And in addition to that, GDP as the indicator doesn't take into account the benefits of so many things that surround us, such as good weather when it replaces the use of energy, or for example the work of housewives, volunteering, etc. However, GDP remains the most widely used indicator, the most widely used among other economic indicators, because of its simplicity and through its relevance of what is the subject of questioning. So there's also another limitation of the measure of wealth explained through this, as shown even centuries ago on the example of a broken glass of the window, because when society becomes impoverished by the value of the broken glass, this doesn't mean that when society loses the value of some object, that objects that are unnecessarily destroyed, that destruction doesn't necessarily mean anyone's profit. So GDP is also the manifestation of an ideological anti-accounting misapprehension, since it's actually accounted for governmental spending and some kind of creation of wealth. And therefore, with this method of calculation, it is deduced that reducing state spending leads to reduction of GDP, and therefore a balanced budget of a reduction of the public debt would be economically unfavorable. Just to conclude, the growth of GDP doesn't always mean that the society is doing better, that the quality of life is being better in that society. It was never before case in the history, and it will never be the case, especially now when we have more and more factors that should be included in the economy and the technological perspective at first place.